Hey everyone, I know it's been a very long time, but we are here to talk about eating disorders today. And I will be joined by one of my colleagues who did a talk this week at our workplace talking about eating disorders. And they have joined, so let me just invite them to this. Can you send me a request to join, Neil? There's just going to be a plus option next to your name, or I can invite. I think I just invite. Hey, you're here. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you doing?
Yeah, not too bad, not too bad. First of all, I want to make sure that I get your name correctly. So is it Neil? Neil?
Like the river in Egypt, you can always just go with Nile.
Okay, so it is Nile. Okay. I was conscious because I was worried that, you know, Nile is like the most common pronunciation, so I don't want to get it wrong, but okay, it's Nile. Okay, that's good. Great. Okay, we'll probably give a couple of, you know, we said midday, so let's just give another minute for others to join. But yeah, like this is super exciting. I haven't done this in a very long time. Usually, you know, we'll just talk about your experience. We'll see if people have any questions and we'll just, you know, get to know you, get to know a lot more about eating disorders and how can people, you know, ask for help, get help. And, you know, sometimes it could be a little bit difficult to just, you know, put your hand up and say, I'm not okay. And I think conversations like these make it very, you know, the more we discuss about it, the more normal we can be about such things. So, yeah, over to you to introduce yourself to everyone.
Yeah, so I'm Nile. Yeah, and as Radiba said, basically this week, it's Eating Disorder Awareness Week. So this week I basically did a session at work where for the first time I kind of opened up about my experiences. And just for anyone watching, obviously, like I'm through it and I'm kind of through that journey. But if I thought it was really important to kind of share what I was going through, kind of how it started, and also just kind of some advice on sort of how to kind of get through that and then kind of basically like deal with it and kind of live with it. And I think that's the thing I always learned was it's about living with it rather than actually sort of treating it and just having it gone completely, essentially. And it was really good reception, actually, I think, from everyone at work who joined the session. It was from across thousands of people. We had like 40 or 50 people, but it was really nice to kind of share that and have the response from it as well. So
yeah, absolutely. So, you know, whenever I think about my own journey as well, I always start with what were the first signs when you noticed that, you know, this is not okay and, you know, maybe I need help. And so, yeah, what were the first signs, Nile?
Yeah, so because I went through cycles, essentially, and I went through sort of anorexic cycles and bulimic cycles. And it started with the anorexic cycle, essentially. And it was sort of around 2014, 2015. After I left university, I actually was one of those people that lost weight at university, essentially. And I got comments on that, like, oh, you've lost weight, like, you look really good. I was at a healthy weight, so I wasn't, like, really, really sort of, like, skinny then. It's when I moved into London and started my first job, I obviously had to be conscious of money, and I had to really think about sort of what I was doing, what was it like. I had to basically student and still eat like a student in a way just to pay my rent. So what happened was I found a job that was local. This is a very long-winded story, but it does lead up to why it happened. So I started walking to work, so I started like doing a bit of exercise, a 45-minute walk, and then I came across this app. And this is why I'm often quite worried about these apps existing and kind of always try to warn people who are using them that counts calories. And I went numbers because that's one of the rules that you always have in a discussion group about these, is that you don't mention numbers, you don't mention calories, but I'll use the word calories. And then it started to become, I was checking the app more and more often, kind of counting those calories. And then it became a game in a way where I was just like, oh, if I manage to lower my calories and then do my exercise,
yeah, then
that's kind of okay, and I'm kind of like doing this. And then it just got progressively worse. And the thing was, I didn't notice that it was getting worse. I just thought it was part of like living healthy in a way. And it wasn't until I had started getting comments of like, well, your face looks really drawn, you look really tired all the time, and kind of the amount of time I was spending on this app and looking at these things, the amount of time I was kind of making changes to how I do things. So I would, yeah, like I'd walk instead of taking the bus, or I would do stuff like that, or like start to worry about, oh, I've had two drinks tonight, that's X amount of calories. And it wasn't actually, so this went on for a while, but it wasn't until I sort of felt like I had to move home, that I kind of go, I think there's something wrong here. And it was a couple of weeks after moving home that I actually collapsed while I was out with a few friends, and was taken to the hospital. And then when I was in the hospital, they were like, you are severely underweight. You can't, your body can't support itself, and it can't continue doing this, essentially. So it was, that was the point, that was the turning point. But there was all these like signs beforehand of like the obsessive looking at the app, the obsessive exercise, and kind of making sort of shortcuts in meals and things like that, that were kind of like the build up. But until something drastic happened, I didn't really know that that's what it was.
Yeah. So I'll be honest, I am on one of those apps as well, MyFitnessPal, where I'm trying to, track my calories, and I beat myself up to, not working out. So now you say that you have recovered. How do you find a balance of maintaining good health versus not making it obsessive? So, where is the balance? How can anyone watching this find that balance?
It takes a lot of mental effort, and it takes a lot of work. I will admit, and it's part of living with it, is that there are times where I can't, you can kind of remember what the numbers are from those apps, and you kind of look at these things and go, actually, I know that this is X amount. And it was about kind of creating a structure and a plan, and go looking at it realistically and going, well, I like science says, like I do, I have issues with BMI, I have issues with all these sort of things, and kind of what they say and calorie intakes, because everyone's different, everyone has different needs. But kind of learning what your body needs to keep going and turning it around to go, actually, no, these negative numbers and these positive numbers that you're putting into this app based on exercise or food, realistically, you need to hit a point each day, otherwise you're not fueling yourself. And it was kind of having to drastically turn my viewpoint on food to being like, well, this isn't a, it's not a game, it's, food is fuel, you need it, you need to be able to do this. And then kind of learning to accept when sometimes it slips as well, that was the hardest thing. It was like, it was something simple, it was like going out for a meal, maybe overindulging slightly. It took a while for me to kind of wake up the next day and not go, right, I need to exercise, I need to do this. It was just like, actually, no, you had that meal, that's one meal in a week, it's fine. And eventually I kind of pulled myself away from the app. So what I had to do was change the way I use the app to be more about losing calories and more about actually, well, I know I need to hit this number of like 2,000, like whether I've exercised or not, that's like the minimum I need. And then it sort of built up from there. So there's a lot of change, a lot of reading, a lot of changing and understanding what the body needs and what my body needs specifically to keep going. And then eventually what was quite nice is that I didn't need the app anymore, because I could kind of logically see, well, this is that, this is that, this is what I need. And also just putting more structure around eating times, because something that does happen is, I mean, it can go either way. You can either obsess over your eating times when you're anorexic, so you're like, I have to eat at this time, and I have to eat this much, and it has to be this. Still having that structure, but kind of just trying to be less worried about what happens within those moments.
Okay. And for people who are watching today, I think there's a lot of anorexia is still something that people can understand, but I know for a period you also suffered with bulimia nervosa as well. So if we can just talk a little bit about that as well, and what that disorder means.
Yeah, so I always used to, I'm a big, big Star Wars nerd, and this does have a link, but I always used to kind of joke about the fact that it was like being a Sith, is that the Jedi always say Sith only deal in absolutes, and anorexia and bulimia are two absolutes on the scale. Essentially, one is about being very restrictive, and the other about is losing control and kind of going full on. And my experiences with that were, I mean, I actually remember the exact point that it happened as well. And it interestingly can be part of recovery. And I know that sounds a bit counterintuitive, but you, when you're going out of an anorexic cycle and you're starting to eat more and starting to build up that kind of, yeah, that routine again, is it can be quite easy to tip over the balance because you've kind of been so in control for such a long time that you want to maintain that control. But then if it tips the other way, then you start to feel it's an internal feeling. You can feel it within you that I need to get rid of this somehow. So I was a purge type, but in regurgitation. Sorry, guys, I know it's lunchtime in the UK, but I apologise. So it was that kind of feeling and it pushed you to do it. And then the problem with it is that that sense of lack of control actually takes over more. And everything becomes about the binges and the purges, essentially. So that's all you can focus on. That's all you're thinking about. And it can go, it can get really, really, really difficult because it can be like 3 or 4 times a day at its worst. And these cycles would go on for months as well. So it's very, that's the point when you feel your lowest, because people always say that, oh, the anorexia, you feel like tired and your energy's gone. But I found bulimia worse because it was like, I'm not in control of myself. That everything is this. And then when you try and talk to people about it, they really don't understand that it's like your mind takes over. And that's all you can do.
Yeah. And like for me as well, you know, when I have low mood cycles, Niall, I feel like I want to just stuff myself silly. It's just, I think, just reinforcing the fact that, you know, I'm fat or I'm not good, you know, I'm not worthy of love. And, you know, if I eat a lot more, probably the hollowness that I'm feeling within, that is going to, you know, fill me up with like some kind of emotions. It's like, for me, it is like, because I cannot, you know, point a finger on like what I'm feeling physically, but it's more mentally that I try and stuff myself. And it's not to like enjoy a piece of cake. It's not to enjoy like a good curry. It is more like, I just, you know, like you said, like you don't feel in control. It's just like your mind is controlling you to like, you know, you're not hungry, but you just want to eat. And so probably worth venturing into like, what are the emotions that you go through when you are anorexic or, and, you know, apologies if this is a bit distressing for you to talk about and for people listening as well. But
So, I mean, the interesting thing is, I kind of talked a little bit about this because for everyone's reference, when we were kind of talking internally at work about this, I kind of went through some of the sort of impacts that it has on your body. So anorexia, if you think about it sort of medically and scientifically, your body doesn't have enough energy to keep going, which means your brain doesn't have enough energy to think logically. So it was often, and I kind of mentioned it as well before, but like about depression coming out of an eating disorder, I wasn't depressed beforehand, but I think during, well, I say I wasn't depressed, but that's a sliding scale, I think, generally, but during and then after, I was very depressed, because no matter what I did, no matter how much weight I lost, no matter what, I still didn't feel good enough. I still didn't feel I was skinny enough. I didn't feel I was like good enough to do anything. And because my brain wasn't working properly and I was trying to work and trying to do stuff, I just didn't feel, I just felt horrible throughout the whole thing. And then there'd be times where I just kind of wanted to sleep a lot and just kind of not really do anything. And you become less inclined to kind of go out and see people and hang out with people because you just don't have that energy, and then that adds to it. So you kind of, it's like a spiral, and you just keep going down and down and down with all these things going on. And it is just because you can't feel yourself to kind of deal with it and kind of go, actually, you know what, it's okay. Like, you're going to have a bad day. Every day starts to feel like a bad day. And then it's, yeah, but you have moments where you go out and you feel great and you're like, oh, actually, no, I went out, I saw my friends, I feel amazing, but it's very quickly back down again. And it's also, I mean, it's quite interesting that anhedonia, which is often linked to depression and kind of like losing sort of interest in things, kind of is part of anorexia and bulimia as well, because your mind is kind of like, well, that's the only thing that I need to care about, that's anything that's important in my life. So I felt like I had no purpose, and I felt like I was just severely depressed during that time.
And especially with, you know, I was thinking about it during December time when, you know, there's Christmas or like parties as well, when you're going out and you everyone is like enjoying a drink or eating, you know, it prob mostly in the culture that I belong to, Indian culture, you know, celebration equals food. There is no, and I think that's true for like, you know, for Christmas time as well, for weddings, like, you know, everything is just about food, about how you're looking. I think the first thing that we do is when we look at people, we compliment them. Oh, you've lost so much weight. Oh, you look really healthy. Oh, have you been working out? So how, what suggestions would you give to people, especially for, you know, how to be mindful of the kind of language that we use? I always say that we don't want to tread on, we don't want people around us to tread on eggshells, but what advice would you give to people just to be careful of the language?
Yeah, so I mean, I fully get that because I think one of the things I mentioned as well the other day was that, yeah, society and culture. So things like Christmas, Easter, anything that's kind of like even Pancake Day, like just so everyone knows, I did enjoy Pancake Day this year, and it was great. But those kind of things are all about food. And I think from a personal perspective, I mean, from a support perspective, it's slightly different. I kind of had to. A lot of work I had to go through with my parents to kind of go, yes, I know this is all about kind of chocolate and things like that, but can you think about like what you get me or what you put on the table and stuff like that during those times? But it is just kind of trying to frame it, trying to help the person frame it in a way like this is a celebration, it's an event, it's once in a year. Because one of the things I find like a lot of anorexics and bulimics who I've met and kind of talked to and shared my sort of experiences with and learned from is that you seem to think it takes forever or like what that one moment will be like a lifetime of like having to recalibrate and kind of lose weight or like purge or do whatever. And it's about the way those events are framed, and how it's okay, it's just one day. It's just one day. You don't have to go crazy. Just enjoy the things that you kind of missed potentially on that day. And I think that's actually quite a nice first step. But it is, those other comments are quite dangerous because the whole like, oh, you lost weight, you look really good, is that when I was at my worst, I would cling on to that. So I mean, one of the things I always think about is it's the separation of weight and health, I think is really, really important. So it's okay to say you look healthy. I think because that's because health and healthy looks different in so many different people that if you can say that, that's fine. But if you focus too much on weight, especially if you kind of know that that person potentially has been having a few issues, it's that those are the kind of words to avoid. And I think also just pushing, don't push. Like I think my dad, bless him, he tried, he didn't understand. He's from a completely different generation. It was like he was pretty much the just eat a burger kind of person, but I think he learned over time you don't push. And actually, it may sound like you're talking to a child or even like a dog or something like that, but just noting that yes, the food has been eating, and then reinforcing some positivity around that, saying even if it's not a lot, if it's more than it was, just being like, oh, it's just really nice to see you do, and it's really. You actually kind of enjoy that, and then actually just talk about how the person's feeling about it because it's one of the things you can always do is you can externalize as well. So don't treat it as an internal thing. You can kind of talk to the person you're supporting and saying, "So what is the eating disorder saying now? How is it making you feel?" So it's not in you; it's outside, and it's something you can talk about. So I know it's very wishy-washy kind of ways to support, but those are the kind of things that I kind of experienced and thought worked pretty well.
And I see my depression as this dark, thick black veil. So like you know like a cloth on me, which is so heavy that just, you know, I can't see past it, and you know, I can't push it away from me as well. And that I think also helps to articulate how I'm actually feeling. And you know, like you said, you know, just name your you know, mental illness something else, and just, you know, call it, I don't know, X, just to, you know, make sure that it is not you, it is just a part of you, isn't it? In terms of when we talk about like therapy or medication, like is there any specific kind of therapy that helped you or help people with eating disorders?
Yeah, I mean, it's I because it's one of the things I think at the time, because I was in around about 2015, 2016, that I first started to kind of seek help for it. And I think things have come a long way in terms of the support that you can receive. I think at the time, GPs specifically weren't particularly useful. There might be some GPs out there who are great, but mine wasn't. But there are so many really good sort of charities and organizations who offer some really good options. So I tried everything, and I've always been, no matter what your condition is or your illness, it's what works for you.
Yeah.
Day. So I tried everything, because I was like, I will literally go through every single thing to see what works for me. But for me, it was CBT.
Yeah. It was
really good. But the issue with CBT is it focuses on one thing. So I sought out CBT when I was anorexic, but I didn't actually get an appointment until I was bulimic. So what was quite difficult was we were focusing on the bulimia, but really the anorexia was the heart of it. That's where it started. And it was, so it helped me kind of get over the bulimic cycle. But there was still always this kind of heavy thing in the back of my head, which was the anorexia talking, essentially. But the other things I kind of had, I actually was put on sort of formal medication, which has helped. And it definitely still helps to this day, that I still take it. And I still kind of feel like I can just get on with my day. I know there's a lot of issues around medication and kind of people saying that they don't think it's the right way, but I think it does help. Not the cure-all. It's just something to kind of support you as you try and make changes in your life to do what you need to do. But the thing that I found best out of everything was support groups. With social isolation, and withdrawal, and how you're spending so much time on your own, just sitting in a room with people who understand how your brain is working and the emotions you're going through and how you're feeling was the best thing. For me, and I was actually part of two groups. So at the time there was only one men's group in London, so I'd go and join that group, and it was just interesting to hear kind of how these guys kind of got to where they were and kind of the situations they were in, and even the different ages. And that was something I think I really appreciated you sharing around those facts and sort of myth busting sort of information during the week, is that it's not just teenage girls. It is like there's guys in their 60s I've met who are still struggling. And then I did also join a group which was mixed, but I was the only guy in the group. But both of those groups helped me. They really kind of gave me a space to talk about it. And again, that externalizing thing, you're all externalizing it together. And you can hear from other people how they've got through it, which is part of the reason why I've decided to kind of try and do these things now, is because just hearing about those things helped, and seeing people succeed was, I think, the main thing that helped me. But there are all those options out there. So if you want to go down the medication route, look into it. If you want to go and do the support groups, because even a lot of these support groups are online now, obviously, thanks to the pandemic. So it's even easier just to kind of take part in them.
Yeah, absolutely. I think pandemic has been such a blessing in disguise, I would say, because I've been able to like talk to so many people, you know, worldwide, and get everyone's stories on Just Another In Less, all thanks to the pandemic. Otherwise, I think it would have been very hard to meet in person and shoot something. I was just thinking right now, you know, I think when I was exploring in therapy about like my own, you know, struggles with depression, I kind of figured out it had a lot to do with my belief system. Like, and it was, you know, the culture that I was born in, the environment that I was born in as well. How much do you think like society or your belief system or your upbringing, your parents, your school has an impact on you that can potentially probably lead to an eating disorder for someone? Like, do you think there's a relationship between the two?
Definitely. I think it's social media specifically, which I think is a force for good and force for evil, depending on how it's used and depending on what you kind of look for. Because I think I mentioned during the week that there's a really good TV show on the BBC at the moment, which is called The Instagram Effect. And it talks about how that basically feeds you all these kind of unrealistic expectations and images, and it does. It really, really does. And because it kind of picks up on those, I mean, it goes through the details of the algorithm. It's crazy just kind of what that does and how it works. But it is kind of how society sees you. I went to an all boys school, and I've often had conversations with people about, oh, but it's an all boys school, surely it wasn't that bad. I was like, actually, no. Not to use the term lightly, but it was way more bitchy than an all girls school, I'll say that much. I was a sort of what you would call a sort of kid with puppy fat, so I was,
yeah,
I grew into it, it's fine, but you used to get comments all the time about that. And about kind of my weight and kind of how I looked and stuff like that. And that does play a role. And then I think there is this thing, and it's still, I honestly think it's still a problem, and it's kind of why I do push the whole idea of men being open about their mental illness, is this idea of you don't talk about it.
Yeah.
You don't cry. You don't get sad. Like, you just get on with it. Like, that's it. You kind of accept, kind of move on. That played a huge factor, because it felt like I had no way of expressing how I was feeling, especially when things were out of control, or when things were out of my control, and I felt lost. I couldn't say I don't know what, I feel sad and I don't know what to do. And I think a lot of it does play into that. And I think British culture, especially, I think we talked about Christmas and stuff like that. I mean, there is like a, most of our culture is based on biscuits and fish and chips and things like that. And it's just like this idea of this, the way mealtime is and things like that, like really, really important. And my mum comes from up north, cooks lovely northern food. I know it probably doesn't sound great to anyone outside of the UK, but it is. So there was always this focus on mealtimes, but also food being a reward as well. Yeah. That was often a big thing. It was just like, oh, if you do well in this, then we'll take you out here. Or if you do really well in that, then you'll get like an ice cream or something like that. And those things do factor in, and they do become part of who you are.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. And it's what you were saying about how that sometimes you have that hole in you that you need to fill.
Yeah.
If it's, you'll do it with food, because that's what you associate with, essentially. It's like, oh, I remember I used to get a biscuit if I was feeling sad, so I'm going to eat a load of biscuits because it made me feel better, but it doesn't. So there are those things in there,
yeah, absolutely. And you know, like eating disorders, you know, like I remember, so I don't have an eating disorder, but I have always been on the heavier side in my life, and especially after I was diagnosed with hypothyroidism, I put on a lot of weight as well. And I still remember that, you know, once, I think it was in 2011 or something, or I was in India at that time working at one of, you know, the big four offices. And there was some joke that was running around at the expense of me and, you know, my heaviness. And I still remember how I don't remember the actual words, but I still remember how I felt at that time when, you know, I felt ganged up. I felt like everyone was just like, you know, together and talking about me. Then I lost a lot of weight in 2017. And that was after, you know, I got a full body analysis done, and how I used to feel at that point of time as well. But I feel like, you know, you can, when I was on my heavier side, actually, and I just moved to London, I was a lot more confident and outgoing person. And I used to feel, you know, comfortable in my own skin. And now, I don't know, because I lost weight and I've gained it again, I feel really conscious about, you know, how do I look? Do I look okay? Or I feel, you know, I don't like dressing up, because when I see myself in the mirror, I'm like, oh, you know, why have I come to this point? So it's not about, you know, oh, I want to be healthy. It's more about how I see myself and how I perceive other people see us as well. And, you know, like you said, I don't know, I want to get your thoughts on this, Niall. I've tried to follow a lot of body positivity accounts, but I feel like I don't get that positivity. I look at it and I'm just like, oh, okay, like there's not like a bad feeling or not a good feeling, but it's just like, you know, this is not anything to do with positive body positivity for me. Like, I can't see that positivity. I don't know what your thoughts are.
Well, I've because I've been sort of trying to basically fix how I see the world externally from me as well, because I think that kind of does, and that's where body positivity does help, because it's kind of actually like there are people who, because there's been a long, long history of, especially people that are considered overweight, of being told that they're unhealthy.
Yeah.
Told that that's not right and that's not the way to do it. And that's why I actually kind of appreciate people turning around and going, actually, no, I'm fine with this, and I am healthy, I do eat healthy, I still exercise. And as you're saying, like, there's so many like internal things that could happen, like hypothyroidism, which you can't control, and it's no use having people tell you that that's, you look wrong because of that, because that's not, we're all different shapes and sizes. Like I had to deal with years for the fact that I'm actually quite stocky, because that's what my bone structure is, and that's what my family are like. We're all quite short as well, so it's kind of, yeah, and trying to accept that actually that's just different people, different cultures, different, like everything's slightly different. So I do think there is some good in it. I think I have seen some of the bad sides of it, where some people who I am just like, you're using this for your own like self-image and not actually supporting anyone with it. And it took me a while to kind of get up to speed with them, with myself, and kind of go, this is okay, like this is fine, like as long as that's the whole separating health from weight things, like as long as you feel healthy and as long as health is important, great, but don't go too far either way, basically, of like pushing people to say like, well, you look too skinny, you look too fat, you look too this, you look too whatever, essentially. But it's such a, yeah, like I find I felt it a while, I felt the same as you for a while, I was kind of looking at it being like, oh, I can't really like get on board with this. It just took time and kind of finding the right people who were kind of saying the right things and kind of approaching it in the right way. Because I have honestly appreciated seeing, and I do pay attention to kind of what happens on TV and things like that, and how adverts have changed and how sort of models have changed and things like that. Because I caught someone the other day, there's a model called Daisy Lowe, I caught someone the other day going, oh, hasn't she got big? It's like, so? Like, yeah. Still modeling, she's still kind of going out there and putting herself out there, and that's great. I think, yeah, she should, like, yeah. And then she's happy with who she is,
yeah,
that's,
yeah,
fine,
yeah. Yeah, I feel like as a society, you know, I don't know how we've reached this place, but you know, being slim is equivalent to being beautiful, and you know, being fat is equivalent to being ugly, and I just feel like it's so unfair, and it just puts, you know, like, when did being a certain body type is a kind of an adjective or looked at it that way, right? That, you know, probably telling someone that, oh, you look really good because you're working out, we should probably, you know, start using things like, oh, I like, you know, that you're looking after yourself, and I'm inspired that probably I need to look after myself as well in a more healthy way, you know, instead of saying, oh, I'm going to diet, I'm going to have better options, and, you know, so that it doesn't feel like, oh, I'm choosing, you know, a carrot over a chocolate. But it is, sometimes it's okay to have a chocolate as well. And it's not just about the numbers or the, you know, your waist size or the size of your clothes, isn't it? But yeah, it's just like, I think the way we have been wired for centuries in our head, that something comes in fashion and we are all just like, oh, you know, this is popular, so I have to look this way to, you know, to look a certain way. Yeah. But thank you for sharing this. You know, I feel like I still don't know a lot about eating disorders, but talking to, you know, people like yourself, Niall, it definitely helps me to open my own, you know, the narrowness that I have. And just, you know, thinking that, you know, sometimes I need to be very mindful of what I'm saying as well, just, you know, because you never know what people are going through, right? And what they're feeling. For the people who are watching us, if you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the comments and I can ask Niall. But, you know, any top tips, any parting words, Niall, for anyone watching?
So I think, I mean, obviously, I think the whole externalizing thing, definitely. I think that's sort of like really, really important. If you do know someone, or even if you kind of feel that you may be going through that, try to externalize it and try to think of it as something that you can kind of, because once you externalize it, it's something you can deal with better. Talk it took me a very, very long time to actually kind of at least talk to my parents about it, talk to my friends, and kind of say, look, this is why all these things are happening. If you're supporting someone, patience is definitely a big thing, because it took me 3 to 4 years to kind of get to a point where I felt okay. And I think during that 3 to 4 years, I was going through an anorexic cycle to a bulimic cycle to an anorexic cycle. So it was going around and around and around. So my parents had to have a huge amount of patience just to kind of deal with me. And luckily I had like cousins and things, because I think support networks are really important. And it's a bit of a weird thing, but I kind of mentioned it the other day when we did the work one, is that I did lose some friendships during the time that it happened. But the same time, I kind of realised who was actually more important to me, and who was actually going to help me through this and kind of just accept me for kind of what I was going through, and then want to see me kind of come out the other end of it as well, rather than just being like, right, I'm done with you because you're not fun anymore, because you don't want to have a drink or like go for a dance. Because that was a big thing about British culture, is drinking, and that is an absolute minefield for anyone who's kind of like anorexic. And I think also it's just knowing that there are resources out there and there are people out there that you can talk to and you can reach out to. There are loads of people who kind of have already done what I'm doing now, which is kind of offering that sounding board and kind of to go, well, look, I've managed to get through this. But also I think it's also just knowing that, like any mental illness, as I said at the start, it's kind of like, it's not going to just go away.
Yeah.
It's about coping and looking for signs, looking for triggers, learning who you are, where this I found it really, really like good to look at how it started and why it started in my life, and kind of then figuring out what was going on there. And then just kind of, I think that whole idea of it's part of you, it's not all of you. Because for a while for me it was all of me. And it's all I ever focused on. All I was anorexic, that was my thing, or I was bulimic, that's who I was. But just realise, no, it's just a part of me, and it's a part of me that I can work on, just like anything else, like just like reading a book to educate yourself or learning how to play an instrument. It's part of you that you can work on and develop and help, basically. And then eventually you learn, because even to this day, I'll have moments where I will go, oh, maybe I shouldn't have eaten that because it's got X amount of calories in it, but I'm able to get to the point now where I'm like, no, it's okay, it's fine, it's not gonna be tomorrow, it's okay, you can keep going.
Great. Well, thank you. I don't have any questions, but if people post questions in the comments, I will probably direct them towards you. Thank you so much for doing this. I know a lot of people have sent their hearts already who were listening in, and I'm sure this is going to help a lot of people. Thank you, and enjoy the rest. Thank you, Hardeep, and enjoy rest of your weekend. And it was great that we were able to do this.
Yeah.
Hopefully, we can raise a lot more awareness together.
I'll be trying to do a bit more, I think, generally, and kind of being a bit, I think now that I've kind of got it out there, I'm going to try to be a bit more open and hopefully do some great work over the next year.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Thank you everyone for listening. Bye bye.
Bye everyone. Bye.